to the Redskin. Go Redskin.
What's good, Redskin fans, and welcome to the first episode of Redskins Weekly. This is going to be a show dedicated to taking a look at all of the Redskins news articles across the internet from the previous, I'd say, 6 to 7 days. During the season, this will be a Saturday episode. During the offseason, we're going to make it a Sunday encounter. Now, sometimes I may show articles where I'm trying to show everybody how dim-witted the national media is. Sometimes I just want to show you the best news stories across the internet itself as far as the Redskins are concerned. The number one thing sometimes can't be assessed whether I show it first or last. It's just going to be a smattering of Redskin news. So without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at our first story. This week, the Redskins started signing undrafted free agents, so they had to make some room on the roster, and in the process, they cut six players. Defensive back Alex Carter, offensive guard Kyle Fuller, offensive tackle Darius James, wide receiver Trey McBride, defensive back Harlan Miller, and offensive lineman Salisi Huatafi. I'm not certain how that is pronounced, but honestly, the only one that really I know of was Trey McBride, and that's because he was at William & Mary. I kind of knew this was coming, and every year this needs to kind of happen on rosters as you upgrade players. Maybe you find better skill sets at the bottom of the list. One thing to keep in mind, a lot of these guys are probably not going to make the final 53-man roster and will likely be falling into the team's practice squad, which is actually a very big deal. The Redskins, whenever there's injuries in the last few years, let's face it, there have been a bunch, they tend to pluck players off of, you know, the practice squad to do that with. So it's actually a good thing when you see them sign players. It kind of sucks when you see them cut players, but it's a part of the game. Now this one goes right in line with the last article, and these are the eight college free agents that the Redskins signed this past week. I love the undrafted process. In my opinion, there is at least one, maybe two future players on this list. Actually, I could probably look and find three right now that I think could have a possible chance. Ryan B., B.J. Blunt, and JoJo McIntosh. Those three, in my opinion, could make a possible push at the roster, maybe even as soon as this year. McIntosh stands out because, you know, we have a need at free safety, and maybe he could step in and play that position. I kind of view him as a long shot prospect, but we'll see. I love to be shocked or in awe with these players come, you know, camp time, and you start listening to the coaches talk about them, and then you get to see them obviously in the preseason games. And most of the time, maybe you get one good preseason game to determine if these guys are good or not. So the camp time is really, you know, if you want to get a good look on these guys, it's really the telling tale, so to speak. This is actually fan-sided, or Riggo's Rag. And they actually had Ryan B. listed as their number one player, undrafted player, they could possibly turn into, a final roster candidate or a player that makes the team. And I mean, I could see where they're going with this. I mean, he had 18 career sacks. He's 6'7", 280 pounds. You know, he could play kind of a hybrid player. He could play the edge, or he could play defensive end. I would also have to add to that and say that if he does play defensive end, he probably should stack a little bit more weight on. But the guy was a four-year starter at Marshall, and it goes a long way for me to say that he had the respect of his teammates with that. I wanted to take a look at this article. Now, obviously, this is Redskins.com, and everybody knows that Redskins.com is kind of like propaganda. They always try to pump everything because it's the team's website. But they went into depth about talking to, you know, about everybody's draft grades with the Redskins, and they put out this particular breakdown or graph or whatever, and it shows the overall grade. The way things break down, you can really see that everybody contends that the Redskins, the Patriots, and the Jags had the best three drafts, which is just fine with me. I am actually very happy with the way that everybody else perceives our drafts. At the same time, I like to perceive our draft the way that we need it to work. And I'm sure everybody else has their own opinions about how the draft process went. But you can't argue with this graph here when you see several different people breaking it down at once. And a lot of them are critical on the Redskins too, so you should really take that into account. Sticking right here with WashingtonRedskins.com, or Redskins.com, I should say. It was an article I saw, I guess it was a couple days back, talking about how this guy we just drafted, Wes Martin, was basically shaped off of a history or roots of working on a dairy farm, which have made him a hard worker and somebody that doesn't quit. I think they said he did 38 bench reps of 225 at the NFL Combine, which is sick. And then he did 42 on his pro day, which is even more sick. But when you look at the guy, you could, you know, at his history or what his coaches say about him, you could see that this is a guy that's going to get in and work and try to learn the system as quickly as possible. And we need a guy that will step in and day one be able to do the job. You know, this is not going to be some cushy run for him. He's not going to be able to just step right into a starting role. He's going to have a battle. You know, this is something I saw and I was thinking to myself, wow, that's pretty cool. You know, 17-year-old high school sports writer Dwayne Haskins predicts in 2015 that the Redskins may need to draft a first-round quarterback by 2020. And if you look at the thing there, it says the Redskins have drafted three quarterbacks since 2002. You know, this is just a little bit of salt on Redskins' wounds, but the very last line, hopefully RG3 pans out in D.C., but if not, expect them to draft another quarterback in the next 5 years. And lo and behold, of course, it was him that we drafted. Irony. Big news this week. Some people see this as dumb news or why is it news, but Joe Theismann gave his blessings to Dwayne Haskins to wear the number 7. Now, this sparked an unbelievable amount of backlash with fans. It's kind of wild because the fans over on Facebook, they just, I don't know, I'm not trying to hate on Facebook, but Facebook fans just overreact about everything. And the guys over there just, I wish you guys could see what I see on my end. But at the same time, be glad that you don't have to, because there's a whole lot of hate in this world. And unfortunately, there's still a lot that kind of centers around race in this world. Now, while there's none in my heart, I realize there's a lot in others. So those people have to live with their own thoughts and their own ways. And there's words for people like that, but I'm going to leave that off of this. We're just going to move forward. I'm going to say, while it's odd to me that I'm going to see the number 7 running around without that odd, you know, face mask, the single bar ordeal, you know, yeah, that's going to be strange. But at the same time, I mean, it's the world we live in. Things move forward. Nobody has ever worn the number 7. I talked about this in a video a couple videos back, about how, what is in a number? Should they allow the right guy when he comes along to use these numbers, or should they retire him? And we're going to see more of this in the coming years. The 21 is still an ongoing argument, and I believe Landon Collins is going to try to wear that number as well. But Redskin fans were really, really mad about this. Some people couldn't care less. The younger crowd appears like they couldn't care less. The older crowd was continually upset. Some people, you know, kind of in the middle. But in all honesty, I think everybody should take a step back and realize that the words that you use, they do matter. So, you know, think about what you say before you say it. And realize that this quarterback, if he succeeds, will be with us for a long time. Maybe he succeeds with the number and picks up where Joe left off. That'd be really nice. I mean, obviously that's a lot of pressure to put on the kid. I'm just hoping that he builds his own legacy. That's what I want. I don't want him to be, you know, compared to Theismann, because he's not Theismann. You know, I always try to tell everybody has this thought in their brain that Theismann was like some kind of punk or something. But Theismann was not a punk. Theismann was one of the toughest dudes in the locker room. The problem with Theismann was that he's always been an arrogant, cocky prick. That's always been the knock on him. You know, I saw a couple of young guys upload videos in the last week or so talking about what he had said about Dwayne Haskins and the they done messed up. That was all grammar. That was all grammar Nazi type stuff with him. You know, he's a fighting Irish guy. Haskins is an Ohio State guy. There's a little bit of hatred there, you know, between those two schools. Those rivalries run deep. And I think what he was trying to say was he's a Redskin now. He can't talk like that. You know, those Big Ten guys might be able to get away with it, but you can't do that here. I think that's what he was trying to get at. And if he said anything wrong, believe me, Doc would have checked him. Doc is not one to just let somebody get away with something or kiss their heels. You know, this particular story really caught my attention because you got two dumbasses here, okay? Both of these guys, you know, couldn't see a smart idea if they tried. But at the same time, you know, obviously Bruce Allen's got a lot of guys in the building with him to help him out, and they make really good decisions the last couple of years. Some people argue with me till they turn blue about anything that includes Allen, but I keep trying to tell everybody Allen's actual duties are really limited. He's just like the figurehead. You know, they're like, okay, Bruce, make the call. But everybody else is doing the talking. Maybe he gets a voice in the discussion. But at the end of the day, it's like, okay, Bruce, make the call. Because that's what he is. You know, and I'm not certain why he's kept his job. That's a discussion somebody else should have. But this particular conversation was funny to me. Dave Gettleman, who has been everybody's kick toy this week. I'm not going to go in too hard on Gettleman. Actually, I'm not going to go in at all. Because this guy is actually, some of the decisions he's made has led to some good moves for us. So I'm just going to go ahead and say, I hope he stays their GM forever because their team looks like it could be, you know, built a certain way that maybe we could take advantage of. Anyway, I saw the interview where Allen said this and they kind of had twisted a little bit of the story here, made this kind of look like he's trying to say that Gettleman has no clue. But really what he said was, is he had no clue about the Redskins draft board. And he was trying to be straightforward, but you could tell that Bruce was playing politics. And, you know, a lot of people will probably never take things at face value when it includes Bruce Allen. In my opinion, this is just nothing to look at. Two empty suits. Gettleman, to me, tells more lies than he tells truths. Bruce Allen is just, you know, the disappearing act that shows up when things go right. I will tell you this, though. Redskin fans, tell me it's not different this offseason. I think the Fire Bruce Allen chants and hashtags struck a nerve. Opinions? Now, this is a Bleacher Report article. I kind of just put this in here because I wanted to point out how completely clueless Bleacher Report is. I see people post stuff from Bleacher Report all the time. I even see people say, oh, well, da-da-da-da-da from Bleacher Report said that the Redskins are going to do this, do that. Generally, it's always opposing fans, but I want to point this out. First of all, they think that Morris Claiborne would be a good fit in Washington. Now, while I'm not going to argue any points here because maybe he would fit into the scheme some sort of way if he took like the league minimum, but in my opinion, he's not somebody we should chase around the free agent board and pay ultimate money to. Now, the point I want to make here, because obviously, you know, I can sit here and throw stuff against the wall, eventually something's going to stick. They think that he would fit in great and would play great, get this, as the services, the Redskins could use his services opposite Josh Norman, and Claiborne would have no problem beating out Fabian Moreau or Dominic Rogers-Cromartie for a starting gig. Well, I guess these guys have forgotten who the guy that starts right now across from Josh Norman is. Quentin Dunbar, anybody? You know, this is what we have to deal with on a national level, whatever. And you just go slide right up. This is the guy they should be linking to us. But, of course, they put him with the Browns because national-wise, the Browns get linked to everybody now because they make perfect decisions. Oh, boy. Anyway, let's move on. Now, here's one of the bigger stories of the week. Josh Doctson was declined a fifth-year option by the Redskins. Now, I've had a lot of people already ask. Now, I realize that some people don't understand what exactly that headline means. Some people have said, oh, well, that means he's not going to be with us next year, right? No, that is not what it means. What it means is he's still under contract for 2019. What it means is we're not extending an option year for 2020. Now, there's several ways of looking at this. The first one, the Redskins are tired of him being in the locker room. Keep in mind, if they were completely tired of it, they could just cut him. But they're not going to. They're going to keep him because they still think that he could step up and do something. Realize that a lot of the stars around the league, the receivers that make it, the number ones, the guy, you know, that they want him to be, they get between 110 and 160 or so, maybe even some of them even more, targets in a year. Doctson has I think it's like 163 or 164, maybe 162 targets in his career, which is basically over 2 years with two quarterbacks who were not comfortable with him or with the system. Cousins never got to know him because the first year he got injured, didn't play but what, maybe two games? I'm not certain how you would add all that up because it was just a matter of plays in most of those games. So anyway, looking at Doctson from year two and three, Cousins was never in line with him. And let's just be honest, Kirk always did what was easiest, even if it was pushing the ball down the field and getting more yards. I'm just trying to say he always did what was easiest. And I think that he would look at Doctson as, I got to throw a 50-50 ball to him, and there's a 50-50 chance that the ball gets intercepted. I'm not certain that Cousins will ever be a finesse 50-50 ball throwing quarterback. You know, by the way, I am not an expert on quarterbacks, but that's just my opinion. At the same time, Alex Smith came in last year, and let's just be honest, Alex didn't light it up throwing the ball and never was comfortable in the offense. He just started to get comfortable when he got hurt. As soon as he went out, Doctson's numbers ticked up a little bit when Colt McCoy came in, who knows the system better. And then, of course, they plummeted under the rest of the quarterbacks who didn't know the system at all because they were just stepping in off of the street. So looking at his numbers, it's hard to make that call. I know everybody's so based on numbers today. Kind of needs to toss the numbers out with this guy. I actually expected them to pick the option up. And before you get ahead of yourself and disagree with me, here's why. The option is only guaranteed in case of an injury that would keep him out the entire season. We went through this with RG3. I had these same talks with everybody. Folks, he could still be cut after this season, and none of that money is guaranteed whatsoever. You know, with RG3, to me, I think it was just an excuse to get him out the door. Most of the RG3 quote-unquote haters wanted him gone and were looking for any reason to let him go. So they were like, no, we can't play him. Get him out of here. You know, if you play him and he gets hurt, blah, blah, blah. And I got it with RG3 because he'd had that injury before. It's a little different when you're talking about a wide receiver such as Doctson. My opinion is, if they can get a guy in there who's not afraid to throw him the ball, I think the Doctson's numbers are going to take off this year, and you're going to see the Redskins sign him in the offseason. It may end up coming back to bite him in the ass of what we end up having to sign him at, to where we could have signed him at, but it's a chance that you have to take because he hasn't shown enough to say that he's worth $10.3 million in 2020. So I understand the move, but I'm a little bit surprised by it. And the pressure is on Doctson. It's on him. You know, he's got Terry McLaurin behind him. He's got Kelvin Harmon coming in. You know, the Redskins got other guys, Cam Sims. You know, this team is not going to stop and, you know, wait for him, you know, to progress. He's a 22 pick. This is the make or break year for him right here. Now, if you look at what John Kime writes here, says in the past two seasons, he's caught a combined 79 passes for 1,034 yards, and 8 touchdowns as the X or the split end. Now, what I'm trying to tell you guys, those are numbers for 1 year. You know, that's numbers that big-time receivers put up in 1 year. He's not getting the type of targets that he should be. So I'm trying to tell everybody to kind of withhold judgment on that one for now. And we'll return to this subject again in the near future, I might add. All right, now, I saw this article pop up on FanSided, Rigo's Rag, I should say, and it was 3 free agents they should target after the compensatory pick deadline passes. And I completely agree with Trey Boston. If we were to bring this guy in, now I said before in a previous video that it bothers me with, you know, him being in three different teams in the previous 3 years, a la DJ Swearinger. I believe we'd be the fourth in 4 years, or fourth in 5 years maybe. Fact is, Boston would fit pretty well. And I think that, you know, with him turning 27 in June, we should still consider him young. And I think he'd be a good system fit for, you know, what we do on third downs. Possibly, maybe even more. We'd have to see how that worked out. But having a three down, you know, safety that could fit into a defense that uses three safety sets, I think that this would be a good signing. Now, there's got to be something hidden underneath, and that's what bothers me. If you look at the other guys they have here, let's see here. Wisnowski, guard from the Eagles, which, with all the guys we have now, I'm not certain if they make a run at him, but it's still a possibility. Ezekiel Ansah, which actually I have said before, problem with Ansah is last year the Lions tagged him and then he got hurt on the tag. So everybody's a little, you know, leery. But he did have, I believe, like 14 and a half sacks in 2015. So this is a guy that he could be a player for a team out there somewhere, and he definitely would fit in our defense. The problem is, can he stay healthy? And do you really want to bring a guy in that you know gets hurt? I mean, I'm just saying. This was a post that I loved seeing on Twitter when it first popped up on my timeline. Jordan Brailford has already signed with the Redskins. He's the first player to sign this year. And the reason why I like seeing it is because I think this guy could be one of the steals of this year's draft. I mean, not to mention the fact that he was the next to last pick. But at the same time, I mean, this guy is an actual threat to sack the quarterback still and plays good against the run as well. Now, I don't know a lot about what he does in coverage yet. That remains to be seen. Maybe he would be a one-trick pony, a la a Junior Gallette that could actually guard against the run. We'll have to wait and see about that. This was an article that caught my eye, and I'm glad I read it. You know, years ago, I was a big LeVar Arrington fan. And I know maybe the younger crowd looks at this guy as a whiny ass or somebody who kind of goes against the grain, and they look at him as awkward or weird. But I could tell you that back in the day, people thought that LeVar Arrington was going to be our Lawrence Taylor. And he brought a passion to the field that we needed. He was nasty. He was. I mean, if you go back and look at his highlight reels from college and in the pros, the first few years in the pros anyway, he was nasty. Now, obviously, most fans know that a rift between him and coaching, which included Joe Gibbs at that point, led to the demise of his career with the Redskins. He wanted to go against the playbook, and that coaching staff said, nope, it's not happening. And the next year, he found himself in New York and, I believe, injured, and that was the end of it. He ran his mouth a lot, burned a lot of bridges, then came back to the Redskins as a writer and on their radio network that has since been sold. But he was on their airwaves, you know, as an employee of Dan Snyder. Now, the article goes in to talk about how he should have acted, you know, after being drafted that high, and he should have chose friends better and everything to that nature. It's a really good read. You guys should go check it out. It's on the Players Tribune. It's called Letter to My Younger Self. And the last article I want to look at is talking about how the Eagles signed Zach Brown to a one-year, $3 million deal. Now, first of all, let me say that for what the Eagles signed Brown for, that will actually be a good move. Now, the reason I say it that way, you see, when we signed Zach Brown a couple years back, all of us thought we were getting this huge steal. You know, he was coming over from Buffalo. We didn't want to pay attention to the one-year deal he was coming off of in Buffalo, but he was coming to us. He hadn't signed in free agency. It was kind of like how it is for him going to the Eagles now. he signed a 1 year, $3 million deal with us. And I thought he put together a pretty decent year, but there were obvious reasons that he was still a free agent that late in the process then. And there's obvious reasons why he's still a free agent late in the process now. This is a two down player who has some speed. He does. It's more like quickness, okay? But he gets lost in coverage. And he likes to tackle after, you know, a 6-7 yard gain. He's the guy that'll pop up and make multiple tackles. He was one of those best tackler on a so-so front seven. So, you know, kind of guy. But I'm not here to hate on Zach Brown, because I actually liked him until he started saying things about the coaching staff and kind of putting himself out on a limb. You know, and in my opinion, even if he's right, okay, even if he is right, you can't put that in the media, because all it does is stir shit the wrong direction, and it causes problems. And in the end, he ended up finding himself on an island and not part of the plans. And when they needed to pinch off money, they tried to trade him. Nobody wanted him. But when they, I mean, that should say it all. In the end, they pinched him off and they drafted another inside linebacker, a guy from North Carolina who actually is highly underrated. We're going to see more of him come camp time. But to see Brown catch on with the Eagles kind of makes me chuckle a little bit, because I could see that he's going to carry this a certain way into two rivalry games a year. And hey, that's fine. I love to see how he thinks he can cover Jordan Reed twice a year, or any of our tight ends for that matter. You know, he was completely exposed with Zach Ertz last year and anybody else coming across the middle. So it'll be interesting to see what he does with us lining guys up against him, which he probably won't see much of, since he only plays one or two downs every series. And I'm almost certain that he'll be playing behind one or two guys in Philly. So situational player for the Eagles. You know, he was a two-down starter for us. He might not even be a one-down starter for them. He might be a guy that just comes in case of injury. Who knows? But, yeah, I mean, if he plays more than one down a series, then, yeah, he's a steal at $3 million. But don't give him more than 1 year. Word to the wise. But before I click off, I want to tell everybody that this is going to be an every-week thing. During the season, it's going to be a Saturday morning kind of thing. And during the off-season, I'm going to try to make it a Sunday afternoon, Sunday midday kind of thing, and try to, you know, keep up with it as it goes on. I feel like it could be a good segment on the channel to try to keep everybody together on some news and maybe get a chuckle or two out of the national media, as they always mess up and say silly shit about us and talk about how we're going to be like, you know, a 26th ranked defense. I don't know. I'm just throwing something dumb out there that I haven't read yet. But when I do, I'm going to grab that article and push it to the side, and we're going to talk about it in one of these episodes. So that's all I got for today. Hail to the Redskins. Peace.